Great. Good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining. My name is Stephen Lukas, and I am one of EPA's remedial project managers for the Palermo Wellfield Superfund site. As Julie mentioned, the EPA is revising the cleanup plan at the site to treat contamination from the Southgate dry cleaners. This original cleanup plan was established in 1999. And the purpose of this meeting is to introduce that revised cleanup plan to the public and to provide the opportunity for public comment. We will present the range of cleanup options or alternatives that the EPA has evaluated, and we'll present the EPA's preferred alternative. Here's an overview of the agenda tonight. I'll review the site history and the cleanup process. I'll introduce the EPA's proposed plan. I'll discuss the next steps in the process, and we'll have time following the presentation to answer questions. And you may also submit public comments during this time. We have a court reporter here, as Julie mentioned, who will be transcribing tonight's meeting. So let's talk a little bit about where we've been at the site since it was first established. The site is located in Tumwater, Washington. We're a few miles south of Olympia. And the entire site is more or less a 150-acre area that begins near the Washington State Department of Transportation facility, which is across from I-5. And spans down to the Palermo neighborhood near the Tumwater Valley Golf Club. Since the 1990s, the Environmental Protection Agency has managed this site under the Superfund program. The Superfund program is a federal program that's responsible for cleaning up some of the nation's most contaminated land and protecting human health and the environment. The site gets its name from the city of Tumwater's Palermo Wellfield, where the presence of contamination was first discovered. Contamination was first discovered in 1993 during routine testing at the wellfield. The wellfield, for those who don't know, is located just east of where we are meeting tonight and is accessed from the Palermo neighborhood. When contamination was first identified, the city's wells were turned off. And the state and EPA then conducted additional investigations and identified the contaminant sources. There are two different contaminants that were identified. The first is trichloroethane, also referred to as TCE, and it was determined that this was released from two Washington State Department of Transportation laboratories. One laboratory was formerly located near the Speedway off of Trosper Road. And the other TCE source was determined to have been from the Washington State Department of Transportation laboratory that is still located across from I-5. A second contaminant was also identified, and it was determined that the Southgate dry cleaners had released tetrachloroethane, also referred to as PCE. This is the contaminant that we're here to discuss tonight for the proposed plan for cleanup. And this figure shows you where the source area for that contaminant is. Here is the Southgate Shopping Center, so up near the Dollar Tree, just across Capitol Boulevard from where we are tonight. This contaminant, PCE, is commonly used in the dry cleaning process. And as I'll show in a few slides from here, this contaminant entered soil beneath the building foundation through a storage in a sump. And from soil, the contaminant entered groundwater, and groundwater at the site flows towards the Bluff and Palermo neighborhood. So again, here is the source area for the contamination that we are discussing tonight at the Southgate dry cleaners. A bit more on the contaminant. Tetrachloroethane, also referred to as PCE. It's an industrial solvent commonly used as a degreaser and as a dry cleaning fluid. This was used at the Southgate dry cleaners. It is no longer used there today. If released to the environment, this chemical can contaminate soil and groundwater. And since this chemical can volatilize, it can also contaminate soil gas and indoor air. So this graphic demonstrates the concept of the release at the dry cleaners. The sump would have been approximately in this area where contamination entered soil. From soil entered groundwater, which flows towards the bluff. And these little symbols represent the volatilization that can occur in soil. In 1997, the site was listed on the National Priorities List, and subsequently in 1999, the formal cleanup plan or record of decision was released for the site. And specific to the contamination at the dry cleaners, the EPA installed what's called a soil vapor extraction system to treat the soil contamination below the building. This is a system and technology that's commonly used to remediate dry cleaning fluids and other industrial solvents. The system worked in the following way. Piping was installed to reach the contamination from outside the building. You can see here in green. In this above ground system nearby was fitted with a blower that applied a vacuum through that piping and through these slotted extraction wells. And this vacuum essentially pulled vapors from the soil through the piping out to the treatment system where it was run through carbon and then discharged as clean air to the environment. This system operated at the dry cleaners until 2001. And we estimate that approximately 400 pounds of the contaminant was removed from soil through this technology. As previously mentioned, the contamination at the dry cleaners also reached the water table. And at this site, groundwater moves across Capitol Boulevard towards the bluff adjacent to the Palermo neighborhood. In the early 2000s, the EPA installed a drain system right below the bluff along Rainier Avenue in the Palermo neighborhood. And this drain captures groundwater as it passes through the bluff into that neighborhood. And groundwater collected in this drain is conveyed through piping under the street to a treatment lagoon located at the end of M Street in the Palermo neighborhood adjacent to the golf course. The purpose of this subdrain and treatment lagoon was to lower the water table by about 18 inches within the neighborhood, and it captures a substantial amount of the PCE contamination. The treatment lagoon aerates the contaminant, and as it volatilizes, it's degraded by UV rays. And that water is ultimately discharged to the Deschutes River. So why is the EPA taking additional action to remediate the dry cleaners contamination? Well, we've been monitoring the site since the original cleanup began in the early 2000s. And we have found that the cleanup goals established in the original record of decision have remained unmet. We see that there is still some contamination in groundwater and in soil beneath the dry cleaners. So we are now proposing additional remediation at the site to prevent potential exposures to contaminants in indoor air and remediate the groundwater plume. As previously mentioned, the record of decision is the site's cleanup plan, and so we are now putting forth a record of decision amendment, which will be the formal revision to the cleanup plan. A little bit about what EPA has done. Since the early 2000s, we've conducted reviews of the site every 5 years, in which we'll evaluate the cleanup's performance and track the site's progress. Over the last several years, we've been collecting field data to better understand conditions at the site. We've installed and sampled several new monitoring wells and installed several soil borings. You may have seen us out with our contractors and drill rigs over the last couple months this winter performing that work. This year, we completed a focused feasibility study, and we worked with a contractor to evaluate the dry cleaner's contamination and identify possible cleanup options or alternatives. The EPA then evaluated these alternatives, and we've put together a proposed plan for cleanup for the portion of the site related to the dry cleaner's contamination. I'll show a few figures showing the current extent of contamination at the site, and then I'll present the EPA's evaluated cleanup options or alternatives, and I'll present the EPA's preferred alternative. So in 2018 and in 2023, we collected soil gas samples from beneath the dry cleaners. This data suggests that there is still contamination in the soil and soil gas beneath the dry cleaners. Based on this data, we've determined that the original soil vapor extraction system was turned off prematurely, and that contamination remains beneath the building footprint. We've also been tracking the groundwater plume. While the plume is collected by the subdrain at the bottom of the neighborhood, we see that contamination remains in groundwater between the dry cleaners and that bluff. So I'll show the highest concentrations in the groundwater plume are not too far from where we're meeting this evening. And that plume depth is about 50 to 80 feet below ground surface. The highest contamination has migrated about 1,000 feet from the source towards the bluff. So just to review where we're at in the Superfund process, when the site was listed in 1997, we essentially went through this process up through operations and maintenance. We are now have completed a what's called a supplemental remedial investigation and focused feasibility study as we determine that additional action is needed. So we are releasing the proposed cleanup plan for the record of decision amendment. We will finalize that cleanup plan following public feedback, perform the design, perform the remedial action, and then continue with monitoring until it's determined that the site is safe for deletion. So as the EPA is developing the cleanup plan for any site, there are 9 criteria that are used to evaluate the possible alternatives. And I wanted to show this slide to demonstrate the different things that we're reviewing and evaluating during this process. All of the cleanup options that you'll see tonight have gone through this evaluation. The first two are called threshold criteria. Any cleanup plan that we choose must protect people's health and the environment and comply with applicable laws. We then use the 5 balancing criteria to weigh relative pros and cons of the different alternatives. Show these criteria here. And state and tribal acceptance and community acceptance are evaluated following the public comment process. So this slide shows the different cleanup technologies that we evaluated as possible cleanup options. To remediate contamination beneath the dry cleaners building, we identified soil vapor extraction as the primary technology for this purpose. This technology was previously used at the site, is an off-the-shelf technology to treat soil and soil vapors underneath building footprints. To remediate the groundwater plume, we had a few different approaches and technologies available. The first is monitored natural attenuation. In other words, this is essentially relying on natural processes to reach cleanup levels without additional engineering efforts. The second is air sparging. This approach uses forced air with ozone introduced to the aquifer. The air and ozone interact with contaminants in groundwater, causing it to volatilize. And then the volatile compounds are captured using an extraction system. We also evaluated the use of injections to remediate groundwater. And this approach uses drilling to inject compounds or amendments into the aquifer to distribute them in groundwater. They'll subsequently react with the contaminant mass to create less harmful products. Lastly, we evaluated barrier technologies. These also use drilling techniques to inject amendments in groundwater. And rather than injecting the materials and being distributed throughout the plume mass, these are placed in more discrete areas to form barriers in the aquifer. And when groundwater moves through that barrier, it is treated and continues to move through the system. This slide shows the suite of alternatives evaluated by the EPA with notes on their effectiveness, estimated time to reach cleanup goals, and estimated costs. And just a note that long-term monitoring and operations and maintenance are also included in alternatives 2 through 6. The first alternative is no action. And as far for alternative 1, we know from our monitoring efforts that additional action is necessary at the site, and so this alternative was not brought forth for further analysis. Alternative number 2 is soil vapor extraction at the Southgate dry cleaners and monitored natural attenuation for the groundwater plume. Oops. The use of soil vapor extraction would be effective to treat the soil and soil vapor at the dry cleaners. And continuing to monitor the groundwater plume without additional remediation efforts would not achieve remedial goals within a reasonable time frame. So this was not considered our preferred alternative. Alternative 3 is soil vapor extraction with in situ chemical oxidation. In situ chemical oxidation can be performed using air sparging and ozone, as I previously mentioned, or it can be performed by injecting permanganate into the aquifer. Ozone sparging would likely be destructive. There are many variables to contend with using this technology. And the use of permanganate could be hazardous to fish if incidentally released to the environment. And given that our subdrain is ultimately discharges to the Deschutes River, this technology was not considered as part of the preferred alternative. Let's see, alternative number 4 is soil vapor extraction and in situ biogeochemical dechlorination, which is a mouthful. This approach is potentially effective to treat groundwater. However, it requires significantly changing the geochemistry of the aquifer. We would need to change the aquifer from being aerobic to anaerobic so that certain microbes that break down contaminants could survive. This technology was not considered given that the uncertainties around these variables. Alternative number 5 is soil vapor extraction and in situ sequestration. In situ sequestration is a barrier technology that's used to treat groundwater. And the barrier is comprised of a colloidal carbon mix that traps and sequesters contaminants as groundwater passes through the barrier. Alternative 6 is soil vapor extraction and in situ sequestration with the addition of in situ chemical reduction. So this is essentially alternative 5 with the addition of zero valent iron which acts to interacts with the contaminant mass as it's moving through, and creates essentially a dissolved gas from the tetrachloroethane that's passing through. So you have both the sequestering from the carbon and then also the interaction with the zero valent iron. That's where the term in situ chemical reduction comes in. We consider this alternative more effective than alternative number five, given that there is treatment of the contaminant mass in the barrier. So alternative number six is our preferred alternative. This is soil leaver extraction at the dry cleaners, which we are proposing to do through horizontal drilling methods. And this would be installed as a pilot test prior to the Record of Decision amendment to give us better control over design and determine the radius of influence for the system. I'll show a figure demonstrating the concept of the system in just a bit. And the goal of this technology is to reduce vapor intrusion risks in the building and further prevent contaminants in soil from leaching into groundwater. So if you recall the previous soil vapor extraction system figure shown in the presentation, we saw piping running through the building. In what we're proposing, we'd be drilling horizontally beneath the building foundation. So no intrusive work through the building footprint. We'd be using a specialized drill rig to reach the contaminated soil and install our well screens here. And it would work similarly where a vacuum is applied to these well screens. Soil vapors are drawn through the system, treated with carbon in a treatment system outside the building and released to the atmosphere. This figure shows a concept of where our screens would be located relative to the building footprint. So we imagine that these screens would be located approximately 15 feet or so below the building footprint, and they'd be distributed to treat the contaminant mass, as you see in this figure. To remediate groundwater, we are proposing in-situ sequestration with chemical reduction. So with regards to the carbon, you could think of this as a subsurface Brita filter with the addition of iron. Water will naturally move through this barrier and contaminants will be trapped by the carbon and interact with the iron. The ultimate end product of that reaction are dissolved gases. And this diagram shows conceptually what I'm talking about in pretty plain terms, where we have a barrier that would be installed through injecting amendments with a drill rig. Contaminated groundwater would pass through, and as it passes through, we would see concentrations significantly decrease. And note that aside from a few perforations through the asphalt or landscaping, you would not see this technology beyond the drill rig showing up and heading out. This figure shows the current extent of contamination in groundwater in where we expect that we may install these barriers. We anticipate that in the highest concentration areas of the plume, we would install barriers that have both the carbon and the addition of iron. And in the more dilute areas of the plume with less concentration of contaminant mass, we anticipate we may install just the carbon barriers without the addition of iron as a cost savings measure.
So obviously the less dilute areas are the yellow.
Yes, yep, thank you. So It's tough to see with this TV up here. And we have some figures, I believe this figure here, we'll show that closer up. But yes, good point. In the sub-drain at the base of the Palermo Bluff would remain as is in operation. So a look at our schedule moving forward. The proposed plan was released on April 9th, and we are accepting public comments through May 11th. We will review the public comments and begin working on the final cleanup plan following that period. Again, that cleanup plan is referred to formally as the Record of Decision Amendment. We expect this document to be completed either fall 2024 or early 2025. In the coming months, we will be planning to install the soil vapor extraction system beneath the South Gate dry cleaners. Performing this work now will give us some really valuable engineering information to determine the radius of influence of the system beneath the building footprint. And we'll use that data to optimize the system and refine as necessary. So with that, our next steps, please, I encourage you to submit comments or ask informal questions this evening. Julie can work with you on the best means to submit those comments. Following the public comment period, those comments will be formally responded to in the Record of Decision Amendment in what's called the Responsiveness Summary. And so with that, and I've discussed the cleanup process following that point. Here's how to submit your comments, either by email to James or myself, through mail, or this evening through written or verbal comments. Julie?
Thank you.